Hari set off on an epic three-year journey investigating the war on drugs. He discovered three things. Drugs are not what we think they are. Addiction is not what we think it is, and the war on drugs has very different motives to what we see on TV. And Johann joins us now to explain. Thanks for coming in. Pretty powerful observations. I guess we should start at the beginning. How wrong is our concept of drug use and abuse?
Well, one of my earliest memories is of trying to wake up one of my relatives and not being able to. One of the reasons I went on this journey is I wanted to understand, you know, I suddenly realised, you know, I didn't know the answers to really, really basic questions like, what causes addiction? You know, is there an alternative to this system we've been using that doesn't seem to work? And so I ended up, as you say, going on this big journey and sitting with loads of people over 30,000 miles, you know, meeting a kind of really big mixture of people to try to figure out the answers to those questions.
So what is addiction?
Yeah, you know, it's totally different to what we think it is. If you'd said to me 4 years ago, what causes, say, heroin addiction, I would have looked at you like you were a little bit thick and I would have said, well, obviously, heroin causes heroin addiction. It's a stupid question. We think that if the first 20 people in this, you know, the audience here, if you guys all used heroin together for 20 days, on day 21, you'd all be heroin addicts because there's chemical hooks in the drug that your body would start to physically need. That's what I believed. First thing that alerted me to the fact there's something not right about that is when it was explained to me, if I step out of this studio and I get hit by a truck now, I'll be taken to hospital if I break my hip and I'll be given loads of diamorphine. Diamorphine is heroin, that's the medical name for it. You're given it for quite a long period of time in hospital. If what we think about addiction is right, that it's caused by the chemical hooks, what should happen to those people? Some of them should become heroin addicts. This has been studied really carefully. It doesn't happen. When I learned that, I was just totally puzzled. I thought, that doesn't make any sense to me. And I only began to understand it when I went to Canada and interviewed a guy called Bruce Alexander, who's a professor of psychology. He explained to me what's really going on with addiction. The idea of addiction we have in our heads, that story, comes from a series of experiments that were done earlier in the 20th century. They're really simple experiments. You guys can do them at home tonight if you're feeling a bit sadistic. You get a rat and you put it in a cage and you give it two water bottles. One is just water and the other is water laced with either heroin or cocaine. If you do that, the rat almost always prefers the drugged water and almost always kills itself. So there you go, right? That's our story. In the 70s, Professor Alexander looked at these experiments and said, well, hang on a minute, we're putting the rats in an empty cage. They've got nothing to do except use this drug. Let's do this differently. So he built a cage that he called Rat Park, which is basically heaven for rats, right? Anything a rat can want in life, they've got in Rat Park. They've got cheese, they've got coloured balls, they've got loads of friends, they can have loads of sex. And they've got both the water bottles, the normal water and the drugged water. But this is the fascinating thing. In Rat Park, they don't like the drugged water. They almost never use it. None of them ever use it compulsively. None of them ever overdose. And what I think the main thing this tells us is the opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection. Human beings have an innate need to bond and connect. Mm. And when we're happy and healthy, we'll bond and connect with each other.
So it's a mental health issue.
Mm. Exactly. It's about pain and isolation.
If you're right about that understanding of it, what are the implications for people who are trying to get off something?
Most important is about two things. One is how we treat people individually and the other is how we treat them politically. So Portugal, for example, I went to. In the year 2000, Portugal had a massive heroin problem. 1% of the population was addicted to heroin. And every year they tried the approach Tony Abbott's promoting now. They arrested and imprisoned more people. And every year the problem got worse. So they decided to do the exact opposite. They decided to decriminalise all drugs, but, and this is the crucial next step, take all the money they used to spend on the fantasy that you can get rid of these things, we can't even keep them out of our prisons, and spend it instead on turning the addicts' lives around. It's interesting, it's not really what we think of as drug treatment in Australia. They do a bit of rehab and a bit of psychological support, but the biggest thing they did was the exact opposite of what we do in Britain and Australia. They set up a massive job creation program for addicts. So say you used to be a mechanic, they'll go to a garage and they'll say, if you employ this guy for a year, we'll pay half his wages. The goal was to make sure that every addict in Portugal knew that they were loved and valued and had something to get out of bed for in the morning.
And what was the percentage of recovery?
It's incredible. Injecting drug use, it's been 15 years now, injecting drug use is down by 50% in Portugal. Overdose is massively down, HIV is massively down. One of the ways you know it's worked so well is I went and interviewed the guy who led the opposition to the decriminalisation, the main drug cop at the time, Joao Figueira. And he said at the time things that I'm sure loads of your viewers are thinking now, which is surely if you decriminalise all drugs, you'll have all sorts of problems. He said to me, Everything I said would happen didn't happen, and everything the other side said would happen did. And he talked about how he felt ashamed that he'd spent 20 years making addicts' lives worse before, and he hoped the whole world believed what
was going on. But don't you think there's some role for policing something? We've got a big problem with ICE at the moment, especially in small-town Australia. You've got towns where there are unemployed people and people with difficulties in their life and they're often quite remote communities and they're being flooded by ICE and cheap drug by really evil people. There's a role for the policeman to go and knock on a door, isn't there?
You've got to have it
And say, don't do this, you know?
You've got to have drugs very tightly regulated. One of the things that most shocked me when I looked at this evidence, and this will be really shocking to people, 85% of people who use crystal meth, ICE, don't become addicted, which is incredible. Now, that's not to say it's not a terrible drug in other ways. Of course, that's from Professor Carl Hart at Columbia University, who's done the most detailed study of this. Now, that's shocking, but it's important to understand, well, what's going on with the 15% who are becoming addicts, which is a real and terrible tragedy, and I know that, not with ICE, but I know that with my own family. And the key thing is it's those underlying factors. If you're in a lot of pain and you're cut off from meaning, you will want to be out of it. You know, one of the ways to think about that, you've got a coffee machine over there, right? We've all been drinking coffee, I'm sure, to be this coherent this time in the morning. We could have been drinking vodka, right? Totally legally, we could all be drunk now. We're not doing that. And the reason we're not doing it is not because anyone's stopping us. It's because we want to be present in our lives. We've got things we want to be present for. We've got people we love. We've got connections we love. We've got work that's meaningful to us. That's the core of addiction. Addiction is about not being able to bear to be present in your life. And if we want to bring addicts back to us, which I desperately want to do, we have to make their lives better. One of the reasons the war on drugs is failing so badly is addiction is all about pain and isolation. Mm. Making people's pain and isolation even worse doesn't bring them back to us, it actually makes their addiction even deeper.
Johann, you've got so many fascinating insights, but unfortunately we run out of time. You can read Johann's book, however, Chasing the Scream. It is out now. Thank you so much for coming in.
Oh, thank you so much.